Hi there. Welcome to Breakfast All Day. It's an exciting day because we're going to do a review of Shazam! Exclamation point. It's a movie with punctuation, which I always enjoy. It comes out next week, but we're going to talk about it this week because we've seen it and it's good. And I suspect that you guys are also interested in it. So, Shazam.
Oh, me? Okay, you. Sure.
Well, I'm not going to describe it. I haven't seen it yet.
Matt, you're really going to like it, though, we think.
Okay, we may have to circle back then, because I do want to hear what Matt has to say about it. All right, so...
Somebody does. So,
young orphan Billy Batson has run away from a series of foster homes trying to find the mother who lost him at a carnival when he was a small child. Meanwhile, the aging wizard Shazam, played by Jaimin Hansu, has been spending years trying to find a successor. At one point in the early 70s, he pulls in a young child named Thaddeus Savannah, but rejects him. And Savannah spends an entire life trying to find Shazam. Eventually, Shazam the wizard realizes that he can't be this picky and he's just got to find somebody. And so he bestows his power onto Billy. And when Billy says the name Shazam, he becomes a big strapping superhero played by Zachary Levi. But inside, he's still a kid. And yes, the movie knows you're thinking about big and they even reference it at one point. Savannah wants to strip the Shazam powers from Billy to unleash the seven deadly sins upon the world. Anyway, that's really not important. Ultimately, it is about a kid having to figure out how to be a superhero, even though he is a kid, and along the way, maybe learning the importance of family.
Shazam is an acronym.
It is.
I learned that. I think I must have known that somewhere in my brain, because I know I have seen that 1970s cheesy
show, yes.
There's the cartoon, and then there's also like the cheesy 70s live action show.
Yes. I did a panel at the Paley Center once with the guy who played Billy Batson on that show.
Wow. How was that?
It was great.
What's he up to?
I think he's a florist now in the Valley, but he was quite the teen idol at the time.
He was handsome. So yes, Shazam is an acronym. It's like a bunch of Greek gods.
Solomon, Hercules, Atlas, Zeus, Achilles, and Mercury.
Yes, that sounds good to me. I didn't realize that. Anyway, this movie is just a joy. It's just fun and it's playful and it's so exciting that the DC movies keep getting more fun, right? They were known for being kind of dour, kind of self-serious, whereas Marvel would be a little more playful. And now the evolution from Wonder Woman to Aquaman, which was just goofy, to this, which like gets it right, finally.
It's a good example of the, amongst the terrible mistakes that Kevin Tsujihara was making while running Warner Brothers, because the directive to make all those movies super serious came from him.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, this one's a lot of fun, and you cannot help but think of big during it, and as you say, there's a bit of a bit. David F. Sandberg directed this, and he also did Lights Out, which was really fun. Remember that?
I did not see it. I did see Annabelle Creation, which was pretty good.
I feel like you saw Lights Out.
I saw Annabelle Creation. Which movie was Lights Out?
It is the horror movie with the home invasion with the guy who is blind and the young hooligan punks break into his house
because
they think
that's not Lights Out.
Yeah, it is.
No, that's Don't Breathe.
Oh, what's Lights Out?
Lights Out. That's not the Natalie Dormer movie, is it? No.
Wait, hold on. I'm going to IMDb. I was so certain that I knew it. Okay, wait.
No,
Rebecca must unlock the terror behind her little brother's experiences that once tested her sanity, bringing her face to face with a supernatural spirit attached to their mother. Okay, so I'm super wrong.
Maybe I did see that.
Yeah, Don't Breathe was directed by the guy who made the Evil Dead remake.
Oh, Teresa Palmer and Maria Bello are in Lights Out. Anyway, he's made some horror movies.
Yes.
You can see my confusion, though, right? So it moves really well. It's very zippy.
Yes, it's poppy and it's colorful and it has a sense of humor to it. But it's not so jokey that there aren't stakes and they don't take the proceeding seriously. But I mean, if you go back and read the original 1940s like Whiz comics, they were, you know, it was a Superman ripoff, but it always had kind of a certain sense of silliness to it, even though the the stories were wonderfully convoluted and complicated to get you back to the starting point always. You know, like this is a comic book that had like a talking tiger in it, you know, and there was a guy like Uncle Marvel who was this old dude who had the costume but had no powers.
Well, so right, because we didn't really talk about the whole Captain Marvel thing, right? Because originally the character is called Captain Marvel.
Right.
And obviously...
Because of a long, complicated legal battle.
Right. And so obviously... You can't have a major DC character called Captain Marvel. And Captain DC would be dumb because that wouldn't mean anything.
So now he's just Shazam.
But there was this whole offshoot. There was like a whole family, right? There's like...
Yes. Captain Marvel Jr., Mary Marvel.
Mary Marvel, Uncle Marvel. Like there's, you know, there's like, there's the talking
time. And the movie does find a way to sort of tie into that stuff as well. I don't want to give anything away. They do spend most of the movie not sure what to call him. Like, it's actually a joke where he, you know, like, you know, people on the internet will talk about him and they'll give him these names like, you know, like the Red Hurricane or something, right. You know. And so the movie itself doesn't know what to call this character.
They don't call him Red Tornado, do they?
No, because that's a different DC character.
But it also gets how it feels when you are... alone and kind of isolated. You know, Billy Batson is a foster kid and he's looking for his mom, and he's living in this foster home with a bunch of other kids who are surprisingly well fleshed out, you know, and they're not just like precocious, adorable,
they have personalities,
misfit types. They have personalities, and there's this lovely kind of organic sense of family. It sounds like a mawkish sentiment, you know, but it comes across really in a lovely way.
Yeah,
a subtle, lovely way.
Like they have foster parents who genuinely care for them, who were fostered themselves and genuinely care about these kids, generally trying to give them a good home, but are not like, you know, wealthy by any means. So, you know, I one of the great things about the costuming of this film is not just like the Shazam costume is great, but also like these kids all dress in a way that give them personalities, but they also dress in a way where it's like they have spent a lot of time picking the best stuff at Goodwill.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm not saying that as a shade. Like
it's a good detail.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like I was reminded of Molly Ringwald's character in Pretty in Pink,
okay,
who wore nothing but like thrift store stuff, but you could tell she had an eye mm-hmm. for it. You know, these kids dress in a way that underscore who they are, but they're also, you know, putting it together that way.
Yeah, Zachary Levi is a blast in this. He's got this because he's a big dude. He's like 6'3" and a mm-hmm. half, and so that works really well when he can. You know, he tries to convey very effortlessly. The idea of being a little goofy in that body.
The physicality of like, what the heck? You know, because like, I think for a 15-year-old to suddenly be, you know, a 6-foot-tall man would be crazy enough, but to also be like a superhero.
Right.
And he's very ungainly. It's very funny.
He and Jack Dylan Glazer as the kid in the foster care who is like his best buddy. Is Freddie a real character in the comics?
Yes.
Okay, I don't know. I'll believe you. I trust you.
He's a newsboy in the original
ones. Okay. But they have a nice friendship. And again, like that is where the big dynamic. Let me ask you this. Was Big inspired at all by Shazam? I wonder.
The thing is, and maybe I just didn't read the right ones. My recollection of reading Shazam is that when Billy becomes Shazam, Shazam is pretty much like a grown-ass man and a superhero. And it's not so much the idea of like, no. I'm this teen boy trying to figure out this body. I think that might be something that the movie is adding, which works. It's completely organic.
It kind of depends on the writer, right? Like sometimes he's basically a Superman and he's, you know, and then sometimes you see if a writer, yeah, it's all over the place. Yeah, right?
There have been a lot of different iterations over the years, obviously. Like I've mainly read like the old sort of 40s and 50s ones. And then there was a brief period in the 80s, when he was in the Keith Giffen Justice League, you know, but there have been other, there have been, I, now that I think about it, there have been like mini series and stuff that do play a little more with the idea of like, he's a kid. In
yeah.
This body.
They, that's what they do in the Kingdom Come mini series.
Yes.
Right. And that's how like somebody actually ends up manipulating him because of that.
Well, it does make sense. And then in a couple of weeks, we're also going to get Little, which is a female remake of Big, but with the roles reversed.
Right.
So that will be fun. We'll talk about that soon. So that idea, that kind of body swap idea is out there a lot lately. Yeah, I had a blast. I brought Nick with me. There is some stuff, if you're going to bring a kid, some of the stuff with the statues coming to life and the monsters, like the evil spirits. There's one scene in particular in an office conference room.
There are some mayhem.
Really violent.
Listen, office meetings are terrifying.
Like, well, this is the actual physical manifestation of all that rage you feel during meetings, Matt. There's some intense stuff. If you're thinking about bringing little kids, I don't want the fact that this is playful and fun to suggest that like you can bring a 5-year-old to this, because it's pretty intense quite frequently.
There are a couple of scenes where they kind of lose sight of the tone. And then, of course, they do so in a way that's PG-13. So, like, there's mayhem, but it's bloodless. And it's like, what are we even doing here?
But intense things happen to people.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, I agree with you. And so I think if you can work past a couple of those moments where they sort of drop the ball in what this movie is aiming to achieve and usually achieving, I found it quite lovely.
I think age 9 or so, an 8 or 9 and up is good. So I'm giving it an 8.3. I had a really, really good time at this. So you're hearing a lot of hype. I feel like the hype is justified.
Yeah, I give it an 8. It's a lot of fun.
Okay, so 8.2 is our number. It's at 93% on the tomato meter. And perhaps at some point, Matt Achety, you can see perhaps. It. I yes. think we think you're going to like it. So come back and tell us what you think.
Okay. Don't tell me what to do.
Thanks for watching. Like this review. Subscribe to our channel on YouTube. Follow us at BeFast All Day on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And keep an eye out. We'll be announcing our Patreon very soon.
It's a thing. Bye.
Bye.